Penguin Random House Audio presents Free Prize Inside, How to Make a Purple Cow, written and read by Seth Godin.
Welcome. If you're lucky, your boss bought you this audiobook. It's proof that your company wants you to do great things. On the other hand, maybe you should buy a copy of this program for your boss and let her know that you really want to do great things. Free Prize Inside is not just for managers. It's something for individuals, nonprofits, and CEOs. It's a marketing program for an era where the real marketing happens inside the product, not in the ad pages of a magazine. My goal is to sell you on taking on the challenge of doing the essential task of creating innovation. Not by building an organization that does innovation automatically and effortlessly. That's impossible. No, by creating a desire among individuals to do the work they must do to make innovation happen. This is work that matters, work that's worth doing. If I succeed in inspiring you to try, and then succeed in guiding you around some of the pitfalls, Free Prize Inside has been worth writing and listening to. Prologue. You can't buy attention. Soon after I started my first company while in college, my partner laughed at me. I had announced to the office staff that we would save money by diligently reusing paper clips. If we don't throw them out, there's no reason we should ever have to buy another box, I said, proudly lifting up the big box I had just purchased. My partner pointed out that paper clips were so cheap as to be essentially free, and perhaps I'd be better off focusing my limited intellect on something more pressing. Basically, I was being an idiot by trying to save money on a cheap commodity. Paperclips, however, didn't used to be so cheap. There are dozens of patents for paperclips. At the turn of the last century, paperclip technology was a closely guarded secret. Hundreds of inventors were scrambling to invent a better paperclip. This was soon followed by a big-time advertising battle for paperclip market share. In 1910, when a stapler was a fancy piece of office equipment, advertising your brand of paperclip made a lot of sense. Paperclip manufacturers were in search of a killing, and they knew they could find one by creating a better paperclip or by building a better brand. In the paperclip parable, we see the two foundations that every product that struggles not to be a commodity stands on. One, build something no one else can build so you can charge enough to make a profit. Or two, advertise it like crazy to build a brand so you can charge enough to make a profit. If consumers were totally rational, the advertising wouldn't work. Consumers would consider all the choices and buy the cheapest one or the one that has a non-copyable technical advantage. In a world like that, you'd either have a patent or process monopoly, or you'd be selling your stuff at ultra-low prices and never make a profit. But what fun is that? Before you were born, marketers discovered the fact that if they advertised like crazy, they could turn ad dollars into cash. They realized that they could differentiate their products without changing the products themselves. They discovered that they could charge better than commodity prices without creating a better than commodity product. The reason paperclips are so cheap is that, 100 years later, there's really no room for a major innovation in the way they're designed and produced. Without a technological edge, you've got nothing but a worthless commodity on your hands, something not worth much effort. The only way to make paperclips profitable, it seems, is to figure out some very cool branding and advertising that compels people to pay extra to buy your brand instead of another. But most people, if you ask them, would tell you that they're not overly swayed by advertising, that they buy the right product at the right price for their company or home. But they don't. Until recently, they paid extra for truly effective advertising. Until recently. Remember Mr. Bubble? Or Mrs. Butterworth's? Or Mr. Coffee? There are plenty of products that used to be right there in the middle of our radar screen. Products with good profit margins, plenty of growth, and lots of shelf space. These products thrived because they were average. They were average products for average people with great advertising. It was a great system. Every time the brand marketers spent $100 on advertising and other forms of interruption, they made $200 in profit. They were marketing successfully to the masses and were great at squeezing every dollar out of the process. They were able to charge non-commodity prices because they'd created a brand. Today, 20 years later, it's easy for a marketer to get nostalgic about this. One product after another is fading away for a simple reason. The ads can't pay for themselves anymore. Not only can't we make our paperclips profitable with advertising, it's getting difficult for vodkas, cars, and accounting firms as well. What we've learned is this. In an era of too much noise and too much clutter and too many choices and too many channels and too much spam, you can't make a good living by interrupting people over and over. The TV industrial complex, that graceful cycle that repaid advertisers with ever-increasing profits, which led to ever-increasing ad buys, seems to be crumbling. The moment the formula turns negative, smart marketers flee. They realize that building a brand using interruption media, advertising, is a loser's game, and they're searching for something else. Jeff Bezos understands that advertising is dead. A year ago, Amazon.com announced that they were going to stop advertising altogether. No more TV, no more magazine ads. Instead, the company decided to put the money it was spending on ads into free shipping instead. Marketers were aghast. The idea of investing your ad dollars into actually making the product better is heresy. Pundits once again proclaimed the death of Amazon. After 12 months, the results were in. Sales for the year were up 37%. International growth was an astonishing 81%. Amazon reported its first quarterly non-holiday profit, attributed to the growth due to the change in marketing tactics. Jeff Bezos and his shareholders are thriving by abandoning the TV industrial complex. They reject the idea that they have to interrupt people with ads they don't want to get. They reject the notion that the only way to build sustainable competitive advantage in a non-technology industry is to have ever more clever ads reaching ever more annoyed consumers. The list of companies that have recorded record growth without heavy dependence on the TV industrial complex continues to grow. Meetup grew to more than 500,000 users without running an ad. The Dyson vacuum cleaner continues to break sales records without obscene ad spending. Wi-Fi has become the de facto standard for wireless internet connectivity for a tiny fraction of the money wasted by much better funded competitive standards. Just because you have money doesn't mean you can trade it for attention by buying advertising. Consumers have learned how to ignore you. On the other hand, there's Red Lobster. When you think of the Red Lobster restaurant chain, do you think, share the love? According to Gary Epstein, chief executive at RSCG Tatham Partners, quote, "This campaign really captures kind of the heart and soul of what people feel about both the brand and about eating seafood," unquote. Huh? Red Lobster is so sure that their new spin on their old restaurants will be effective that they've announced a $60 million ad campaign. $60 million interrupting people with messages they don't want to get about a restaurant they've already heard of. Of course, it's not really their fault. All around us, we're seeing the symptoms of the failing TV industrial complex, but many companies don't seem to be reacting to the decreased effectiveness of advertising as a tool to rapidly grow their business. Why? Because the marketing department doesn't get a lot of choice. The marketing department gets a budget and a few tools. Those tools are things like ads, coupons, and rebates. Given their mission and the tools available to them, it's not surprising that they run ads. It's all they've got. It takes guts to say to your boss, "Let's stop running ads and start making a remarkable product instead." In Purple Cow, I tried to show you how being remarkable is the shortcut to growth. The goal of this program is to go much further. I want to expand the realm of marketing and to persuade you and your peers that everyone in the company is in the marketing department. If your goal is growth, marketing is all that matters, and everything you do is now part of marketing. If marketing is about communicating to consumers that you've solved their problem, then the first step is, in fact, to solve their problem. In our ever more networked world, if you do that well enough, the communication part of the equation is easier to solve. Every product and every service can be made remarkable, and anyone in your organization can make it happen. Section 1. Why you need a free prize. If you were like me, you nagged your mom to buy the cereal with the free prize inside. You bought Cracker Jacks to get the goofy little prize too. We may have known that the cereal without a prize was just as good, but of course, it wasn't just as good. It didn't have a prize. In those days, cereal makers had it easy. They could offer a free prize and create amazing advertising as well. They could charge a significant premium over the generic if they had a talking tiger or a toucan or a cap'n riding a boat.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.